I say good morning and welcome to each one of you today. Today is the day I've looked forward to for this last week. And sometimes I don't always do that quite in the same way. I won't say I never do it, I always do it, but not always in the same way. But today I want to begin by talking a little bit about Philip. There's a lot of Philips, but this particular Philip was born in 1920, and he lived to the year 2001. He was actually born in East Africa, and he was trained as an agronomist, or someone who works and studies soil. He worked as an agricultural development specialist. He was a wildlife photographer and a naturalist. He was also, interestingly, a cattle farmer and at times a sheep farmer. Philip was a graduate of the University of Toronto and the Brooks Institution of Photography in California. However, Philip is probably not known to you because of those things. He's probably known to you because he was a writer, actually. He had a great love for nature and the God of nature. And he became, by some standards, the best and most loved devotional writer of the 20th century. His writings have inspired many people because he was inspired by an in-depth Bible study, intense prayerful meditation, and his passion for sharing spiritual truths with all people. You might know Philip, might have heard of Philip. His name was Philip Keller. He wrote a book called A Shepherd's Look at the 23rd Psalm because he was a shepherd. He was a sheep shepherd as well. And that was perhaps his most famous work. But some other known titles that were quite good, God is My Delight, or his autobiography, Wonder, O the Wind. But my favorite book that this lay pastor wrote is simply entitled Lessons from a Sheepdog. What you see is not always what you get. And this is a true story of a man and his dog. And it's no exception to that proverb. Woven just under the surface of this simple parable, Keller presents profound spiritual truths. It is a story of Lass, a seemingly worthless animal thought to be untrainable, who became a magnificent and valuable sheepdog. Not terribly unlike how God and his love can transform our worst characters, beloved, into blessings that serve to further his kingdom. And so today, with perhaps apologies to Mr. Keller, I want to share with you today lessons that I've learned from a very precocious Mutt Terrier. I want to tell you about Annie and how Annie came into my life. She became known as Annie Dog. Well, I have to go back a little bit. I have to go to my daughter Heidi. This is a picture of my daughter Heidi and I here. We're at standing on the top of Angel's Landing in Zion National Park. If you've never been there, you really want to go there. It's a tremendous place. But my daughter happens to be a firefighter. She's also a paramedic. Here she is on one of the ambulances she works on. And she's just an absolutely fantastic young girl that I am just absolutely so proud of. And she works for Logan Emergency Ambulance Service Authority. They're better known as LESA in Logan County where she's at. And this is a picture of one of the stations that she works at. And there's two points to this picture I want you to notice. In the lower right area, there's a sign for a restaurant you might recognize. One of the most recognizable landmarks in the world, McDonald's, the Golden Arches. And on the far left side, you'll see just a little bit of a building. But if you're from the States, you might actually recognize that style of building. It's a Rite Aid pharmacy. Picture the McDonald's. And the reason the McDonald's is in this picture is because it's part of the story. You see, Annie was a little puppy, abandoned or who knows what, but just this little small thing living on her own, eating out of the McDonald's dumpster and hanging around the 911 center, gathering crumbs from wherever she could. And no one could catch her. She was a wild dog and afraid of people. And right about the corner there, across from that white building there, one day she was in the road and a truck ran over her. Just didn't run over her, just didn't pass by with being over top and she's underneath getting tumbled. The tire ran directly over top of her, broke her hip. And about this time my daughter sees this, and she sees this little dog and its body is convulsing and flopping, and she doesn't know, you know, the extent of the injuries, and she gets a call, emergency call, she has to leave immediately. And she's heartbroken because she's been trying to catch this dog. And so she begs and pleads with one of her co-workers left there to go scoop the dog off the road and hold it till she gets back. Which he did. And so she took this little dog that was probably blind in one eye already. It had some kind of an ulcerous problem in an eye that didn't seem to be fixable. And she tried to nurse it back to health. But she was looking, she was desperately trying to help this little dog. But it reminds me of a text in Luke 15. Luke chapter 15 and verse 8. You remember these stories, these parables Jesus taught in Luke 15 about things that were lost. And one of them, it says in verse 8, either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she find it. In other words, she wasn't content to let this little piece of silver be lost. She's looking, she's lighting a candle, and she's looking diligently. You know, that's the way Heidi was. She was trying diligently to catch this little dog, but until it got ran over, she wasn't successful. But then, of course, its hip was broken, it couldn't run away, and so it was, as it were, rescued. But it reminds me of something I read in Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers on page 484. It says that he that is God looks down from heaven upon the children of men. He sees their perplexities and is acquainted with the circumstances of every experience of their life. He knows when we're in trouble, friends. He knows when we have trials. And he's looking to try to help us, and he wants to help us, even when we are helpless and we can't do anything for ourselves. And many times we are like that. And God looks down upon us in pity and in grace, wanting to help us, longing to help us. But it's not until we are injured or helpless that we submit to His love and care. Isn't that right?
It's true.
And so why do we wait when He's wanting to help us all along? Well, she nursed Annie back to health and somehow, and she got along doing pretty well. In fact, it's amazing how well she did with a broken hip and how she could gyrate that hip at times. But Heidi already had a dog, and she could only keep one dog at her apartment, and she was allowed to keep Annie until she got her better, but then Annie was going to have to go. And so she calls me, Daddy, would you take this dog? I don't want a dog. I don't need a dog. Why are you calling me? Oh, Daddy, could you just at least keep her until we can find a home? Just, you like her. She's a good dog. You like Annie. And I'm thinking, I don't want a dog, I don't need a dog, I don't need this dog. And so I agreed to meet her in Oceana, a little city about halfway between where we each live, and I would pick up the dog. And so we got to Oceana, we met and visited a little bit, and this dog is looking very weary because it's never really known human beings much. It's only learned to know her a little bit, maybe a couple people, but that's about it. She's weary about other people. And she's looking at me like, who in the world are you? And so we she's in a little basket, you know, and she has a rug or a blanket, and we put her in the van, and then Heidi drives away, and this dog, its eyes are just tracking her as she's pulling out of the parking lot. And then it's looking at me, what am I into now? And she became my dog. Now, one thing I have to tell you is that when I picked up Annie first, I don't think she'd had a bath for a long, long time. And somehow to try to comfort her, I took her out of the basket and I put her on top of my lap. And so I'm driving with one hand, petting and rubbing her with the other, going home for the next 15 miles or whatever. And I could tell by my hand, you know, Leon, when a dog's pretty dirty and oily, your hand gets that feeling, you know, and you smell that smell. And sure enough, I knew that when I got this dog home, it would need a pretty good bath. When I got home and got out of the van and looked down at my trousers, which were wool, dry clean only kind of trousers. I'm not sure why I was wearing those not. There was a big brown spot where my lap was, right? So I take her in and I realize quickly that normal soap isn't going to work. And so she's in the bathtub, in this water, and I get the Dawn dishwashing detergent, pour it all over her, scrub her up a couple, three times, 100 fleas floating in the water, the water looks like muck, but now I finally have a clean dog. But you know, sometimes, friends, we ourselves, we are just so filthy. Not necessarily with dirt, but with sin. And we need strong measures, and we can't clean ourselves up. I don't know that that dog could have ever got cleaned up right on its own. It would have always smelled. My Bible tells me that there is something that can clean us up from the worst filth that we could ever be into. In 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, the Bible says, "But if we walk in the light, as He is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin." If we say we have no sin, if we say we're not dirty, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, He says, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a blessing. I like the song, "What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus." In Signs of the Times, February 9 of 1891, we're told that our own efforts are of no avail to atone for sin or to renew the heart. Only the blood of Christ can atone for us. His grace alone can create in us a clean heart and enable us to obey God's law. In Him is our only hope. I want to tell you, that night, I was Annie's only hope. There's no way she was going to get cleaned up. There's no way she was going to have a home. But somehow, she came into the home. She got cleaned up. And she became mine. And then something maybe better happened. I became hers. And I belonged to her. Now this didn't happen all at once. Love doesn't just, you know, people talk about love at first sight. That's baloney. There's lust at first sight, but there's not true love at first sight. Love is a principle. It takes a while to learn to love and trust someone. Trust doesn't happen overnight, friends. When I first got her, I'd keep her inside or keep her on a leash. If I took her outside, she had to be on a leash because I was afraid she'd run away. And so for the first several days, we'd go outside and we'd do the walk and thing and whatever on the leash, always on the leash. And then one day I decided I had to let her go a little bit, see what would happen. Couldn't keep her on a leash forever. And she sort of bolted, but then she didn't go too far, and she'd run around, and I'd call, and she'd sort of come to me, and then she wouldn't come to me. She hadn't learned to trust me yet. And that first day, it probably took 2 hours to catch that dog, to get her finally to where I could get a hold of her. She'd come just like this close, and then just as I would about reach out, and she could tell when I was going to make that sudden move, she's precocious. She was very smart at an early age. And so it took a while to do that. But I learned the kind of food she liked. I learned how to feed her. I learned how to care for her. And she learned to trust me. And I got to where I could sort of trust her too. But you know, trust doesn't develop overnight. And one thing that we need to realize, friends, is that we're going to come to the time of trouble very soon. And we're going to need an experience with God. And we're going to need to learn to trust God now. Because if we don't have a trust for Him then, we're not going to develop it overnight. The crisis is not going to develop our characters, friends. It will reveal what's already there. We need to understand that. But Ann and I, we became one. We would just go everywhere together. One day, went to Grandview Park. Here's Ashley. She was with me and a few others. And we went to Grandview Park together. We ate together. Here she is eating some of my homemade bread. She just loved the homemade bread. That was one of her favorite things. Her bed was right beside my bed. That's where it would be. Sometimes it'd be a little off to the side, give me room to get in. Then when she get in, I get in, I take my arm and I reach over and I pull the little basket right beside the bed, just like it sits there. She'd go to the office with me, and she'd rest on the rug right by my desk, because there's a rug still there. And her reaction sometimes would be like this, because those of you who know my desk area know that sometimes it has a tendency, somehow, mysteriously, to get a little busy. And sometimes I might have accidentally put my briefcase on her rug, or a box on her rug or something, and she would just sort of sometimes pace around and then look at me like, you know, well, aren't you going to move it? And sometimes if I didn't notice quick enough, she'd go over and she would try to lay on top of one of my briefcases. And so finally I'd get the idea, oh, okay, yeah, and I'd realize and I'd move the thing over and she'd go and she'd lay down on her little blanket. She was very precocious. She was very intelligent, especially young. And she has this brother whose name is Bungie. Now it's a stepbrother, adopted brother, I guess, whatever you want to call him. And Bungie, his elevator doesn't go quite as high, if you know what I mean. And one time, for instance, Annie only liked certain trees. There's only one tree that I ever found that she really liked, pepperoni. She liked this. It was made from beef, but it was called pepperoni. And if I gave her anything else, she really wasn't too interested in it. But one time, I had these little biscuits of some kind, treats. And Bungie wanted them. And Annie wasn't so interested in them. But if Bungie got distracted for a minute, as soon as Annie, she'd be watching, as soon as she saw that the dog let go of the treat or wasn't paying attention, she'd rush over, get its treat, go take it, and put it someplace else and stow it away. We saw this happen a couple, three times. It was quite interesting. So she was interesting. She had her ways, and so I guess I have my ways. And so we probably, in many ways, we're meant for each other. But then Annie got injured. And we almost lost her, but she was attacked by two larger dogs, and she was just bitten, torn up, and after many vet visits and operations, she started to do better. After many anxious calls from Europe, I was on a trip to Europe shortly after this, had to leave her, that was very hard, and ran up a little bit of a phone bill checking on her, but she had to be shaved and fixed up and sewn up, but then life could begin anew. And on the 12th of November this year, we got up and everything was just fine, happy. I let her out to go take her walk and assumed that she could have a little time outside because she used to usually do that. She'd go out and spend a few hours in the morning out, play around a little bit, I'd call her, take her in, whatever. But went out to call for her and she didn't come. So I thought, well, you know, she's just up in the woods a little far. She'll come in just a few more minutes. And checked on her a little bit later. She didn't come. By noon, she didn't come. By the afternoon, she hadn't come. By evening, she hadn't come. And I'm getting pretty concerned. I spent half the night in the woods calling, searching. The other half of the night, I slept out in the yard. It was a cold, frosty night, by the way. Just in case she came in because I wanted her to be able to find me and to get inside. But she never came. And we contacted the animal shelters, we canvassed the area, we put up posters offering a reward for Annie, and to this day we don't have any word yet from Annie. But I just want to tell you about some of the lessons that I've learned. And maybe these are lessons that I already knew to a degree, but I maybe have learned them anew, or learn them with a different type of an appreciation that I maybe didn't have before. And the first lesson is simply that there is a great value in life. Not just simply human life, but in life. Life is a gift of God. And I know that some people made fun of the way that I made over and loved Annie, and that's okay. Because I realize this, that we live in a very calloused world today. We live in a world that we have to a great degree lost the ability to love and be touched by others. And so, to most people, it would be the norm not to get too excited in a situation like this. But I want to share with you something from the spirit of prophecy, which is a testimony of Jesus. This is speaking about Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden after they had sinned and began to understand what this was going to cost. And this is what it says on page 62. As they, that is Adam and Eve, witnessed in drooping flower and falling leaf the first signs of decay, Adam and his companion mourned more deeply than men now mourn over their dead. The death of the frail, delicate flowers was indeed a cause of sorrow, but when the goodly trees cast off their leaves, the scene brought vividly to mind the stern fact that death is the portion of every living thing. You see, friends, before humanity became so calloused with all of our war movies and violence and crime and everything that happens around us on a daily basis that we partake of. Before we were calloused, Adam and Eve could see the leaves dying. And they wept and they mourned more than we do for our loved ones today. That's how they understood it, what this sin does and how terrible it is. And it brings death and decay. The Ministry of Healing, on pages 315 and 316. It says, the intelligence displayed by many, and I'm using the term as it is here, dumb animals, approaches so closely to human intelligence that it is a mystery. Pause there. In the youth Sabbath school, there's a story about two dolphins. And one, the lady dolphin had died. And the male dolphin just kept circling her and calling. And he died of grief over that other dolphin. The animals, continue reading. The animals see and hear and love and fear and suffer. Yeah, they suffer. We all know that. They fear, we all know that, but it says that they also love. It says they use their organs far more faithfully than many human beings use theirs. They manifest sympathy and tenderness toward their companions in suffering. Many animals show an affection for those who have charge of them far superior to the affection shown by some of the human race. This is inspiration, friends. This isn't my thoughts. If you don't like this, take it up with the author. They form attachments for man which are not broken without great suffering to them. And I think we all know from experience, perhaps, I hope we do, that it brings us great suffering sometimes too. Don't judge someone in such a position so quickly. Because maybe they're just becoming uncalloused. Maybe they're understanding what life and the value of life really is. Even the value of the, quote, dumb animal. In Psalms 100, in verse 3, it says, know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are the people and sheep of His pasture. Friends, only God is a life giver. Man can try to replicate life. We can try to put things in a chain of reaction to get things going. But we can't create any life. Only God can do that. He is the giver of life, and He understands how important life is, and that it is, in fact, in reality, the only important thing. In the last 35 years, as best I could count, I've owned 11 different cars. I've lived in 7 different houses, each one succeedingly replaced by another. All replaceable. But friends, life, I can't replace life. And you can't replace life. And life is important. And I want to tell you something. It's so important that heaven paid a heavy price for our life. This is a picture of my house. And I can't say that I hammered every nail or a board in every nail, but almost every board of that house I put a nail in. And a lot of labor, a lot of hard work. I was teaching school still when I was building this house. Starting to build the house, and I would teach during the day, and I would come in at 3 o'clock, 3:30, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I'd work till 2:30 the next morning in this house, on the house. I would get up, go to school, teach the next day, come in, do the same thing again. I did this for about 3 months, building this house. And so I've got some sweat, blood, sweat, and tears, and even toll in this house. And I withdrew my teaching retirement to have the money to buy the materials to buy the house. So I've got something in the house. But you know what? I would sign the title to this house over today if I could have Annie back. And that sounds strange to you. That sounds crazy to you. And that's okay. That's expected because you're calloused and you don't understand the value of life yet. But something Annie taught me was the value of life and just how important it is because nothing else matters. You know what's going to happen in this house in a few years? When Jesus comes, it's going to go into decay. I don't know what the weather and the conditions are going to be on this earth at that time, except the Bible speaks of it sort of being a dark time. But you know, this is a stick house. It's made of wood. And wood's going to rot and decay if it's not properly cared for. And that roof is not going to last too much longer. And this house is going to rot and decay, and if there's anything left of it at the end of the 1,000 years, it's only going to burn up anyhow. And the same thing's going to happen with your house and every piece of anything you possess. Don't forget it. In 1 Peter chapter 1, the Bible tells us about a great price that God was willing to pay for us. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18 and 19. He says, "For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold, from your vain conversation or lifestyle received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and without spot." A tremendous price was paid for us, far more than a house. All of heaven was emptied in the gift of Christ, friends, for us. In Bible Echo of January the 1, 1887, we are told that when the atonement is viewed correctly, when we realize the great price that has been paid to rescue sinful man from eternal death, the salvation of souls will be felt to be of infinite value. In comparison with the worth of everlasting life, everything else sinks into insignificance. Oh, if we could only learn that lesson. But you see, friends, love is not logical. Not by most standards. We think that we should live in a logical way, in a reasonable way. People oftentimes will tell us, as some of them, as you're being fanatical. You know, you're being a little narrow-minded in your approach to things. But friends, love demands obedience, and love demands allegiance and loyalty. Now, it's true, it took time to feed Annie, it took time to walk her. Bathing was never fun. She never liked bathing. She wasn't like a lab or something that would just sit there and let you bathe her. She didn't like that process very well. But love is willing to be inconvenienced. Mm-hmm. It is not logical to spend our time, effort, and means on others, friends, but love does. The cross was not a convenient place for Jesus to hang out at. Do you know what I'm saying? Coming to live in sinful flesh. I mean, it would be like us descending down to being like a cockroach. I mean, sin is worse than that. Mm-hmm. Think about living as a cockroach. You know, that's a little abhorrent to us. But I think that humanity and sinfulness is worse. The cockroach is simply doing what it was created to do. Doing it the best it can. In Desire of Ages, page 416 and 417, we're told that Jesus did not count heaven a place to be desired while we were lost. He left the heavenly courts for a life of reproach and insult and a death of shame. He who was rich in heaven's priceless treasure became poor, that through his poverty we might be rich. We are to follow in the path that he trod. Another thing that Annie helped me to understand is that love accepts the unlovable. And that easier is not always better. We live in a world where everything, we want to make it as easy as we can. But you know, just because something's easy doesn't always make it better. Annie at first was not too lovable to look at. She was dirty. She was filthy. She stank. She didn't trust me. And you know, She wasn't housebroke very well. Some of us know that. Put these chucks down, hoping that she would find those as a target if she had to go when she wasn't walked. And she certainly wasn't a quiet lapdog that had no energy. That would be so easy to take care of. Oh, no, 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 no. She was Annie Wiggles.
Hi, Annie. Are you happy? Are you glad?
This is a video of Annie taken a few days before she was missing. And what we see here is Annie just gyrating back and forth. You never know this dog had its hip broke, would you? Watch it. And this would happen every morning. This is what we would go through. She would get up and just be raring to go in the morning. And so you want to go? You want to go? And she's just, and she, you know, as soon as I would look toward the door, she knew that this was a sign to go. She was bolting toward the door. And she would go down the hallway and she'd try to make the turn from the washer to the washing area up to the front door. And there's linoleum there and she would inevitably start sliding, you know. And after a while, she learned sort of how to do a controlled power skid. Leon, you'd appreciate that, running bikes, motorcycles, you know. And she would just be bolting. But this was the way that Annie was. But you know, I was able to somehow eventually see beyond all that dirt, smell, and untrusting dog to see someone that could be a great companion, a trusted companion. As Leon says, you know, the one thing about the difference, great difference between dogs and people is that the dogs will never tell your secrets. But that's the way Jesus is with us too. He sees beyond our faults and our failures. In Romans chapter 5, verse 6, the Bible says, when we were yet without strength, when we were filthy, when we had fleas, as it were, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. In other words, friends, God does not see us simply as we are today, but he sees us as we might become by the grace of Christ. In Desire of Ages, page 667, we're told that for Christ's sake, the Lord pardons those that fear him. He does not see in them the vileness of the sinner. He recognizes in them the likeness of his Son in whom they believe. And in Christ Object Lessons, page 311, it says, then as the Lord looks upon us, he sees not the fig leaf garment, not the nakedness and deformity of sin, but his own robe of righteousness, which is perfect obedience to the law of Jehovah. And I want to tell you something, friends. Obedience is important. Obedience is important. And one of the things that I learned from Annie is that obedience keeps us safe and out of danger. Now, I'm going to have to confess to you that in some ways, Annie wasn't the most obedient dog. She was very precocious. She had a mind of her own. And she had been, of course, raised to be on the street. And sometimes, you know, when we have children and young people and they have a certain background, it takes a long time to correct those things. They don't get all corrected overnight. But Annie at times could just be fearless. Here she is confronting a huge animal, a deer, in fact, many times her size. But as I mentioned to you earlier, there was a time that she met up with two larger dogs, and it left many cuts and tears in her flesh. She had to go to the hospital, and if you look on her back there, you can see those big red spots, those are holes, and she had to have many surgeries. Here she is, after one of the surgeries, she's wearing this cone around her neck to keep her from licking her wounds and the sutures. Here you see in the black back lower part of her hip area, there was a wound, a hole so big there they couldn't close it up properly. It had to just sort of heal up for a while, and they actually stitched gauze or a bandage to her to cover it up while it was healing for a while. Can you imagine that? I mean, none of us had to go through that, besides the embarrassment of being shaven like that. That was a tough thing, wasn't it? But obedience, friends, is important. I want to tell you why this happened. Brother Lee and I, we were actually at his place when her injury occurred. And he and I were going to go down to the road for Bible study, just a little ways down the road. And Annie, she understood the Holtz farm, and she knew where the boundaries were pretty good, I think. And she was able to run there and visit when I was visiting there. And when we were starting to leave, I could tell Annie wanted to follow us. And I said, no, Annie, I said, you stay here, stay. And she knew what stay meant. She didn't always want to stay, but she knew what it meant, okay? And she sort of stayed for a while, and I got thinking, wait a minute, this is Annie. I just had this idea in my mind that she probably followed us. So I called back. We got down about a half mile down the road. I called back. I said, you know, maybe you should go out and call Annie, make sure she didn't try to follow us. And they said, oh, there's already a dog fight going on. And we can hear it down the driveway. And so I rushed back, and here were these two dogs, and they're just tearing Annie to pieces. And if she had just simply obeyed, it wouldn't have happened. You see, she could have saved herself a lot of trouble. She had been safe, but she disobeyed me. And so she was hurt. In Proverbs chapter 18, please turn to Proverbs chapter 18, in verse 10, it says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous runs into it and is safe. Our safety, friends, is in the Lord. Amen. And in following his commands and doing what he tells us to do. But when we don't do that, we can get into serious, serious trouble. And it can be life-threatening. And it can cause us to lose eternal life. In Proverbs chapter 29, in verse 25, it says, The fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be what?
Safe.
If we're trusting in the Lord, walking in His ways, we can be safe. In Isaiah chapter 1 and verse 18, we're familiar with that verse. Come now, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. But then the next verse, verse 19 says, if ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. And so friends, we need to be willing and obedient. Now, Adam and Eve in the garden, perhaps part of their mourning was the fact that they realized that they were the cause of this, that they failed to obey God, and look at the danger and the death that has followed not only for them but for all the earth. We live in a corrupted world, a world full of sin and woe and misery, and we need obedience, friends, to be safe. In the Review and Herald of February 1, 1906, it says, our only safety is found in obedience to God's word, which has been given us as a sure guide and counselor. That's a pretty strong, emphatic statement, isn't it? This is where our safety is found. It's in obedience to God's word and staying within the boundaries that He has given us. And so children, when your parents speak, listen, they have good reasons usually for saying everything that they do. And don't roll their eyes too high. Because you know it's true. And I know it's true. Another very important lesson that I think I learned in a hard, hard way is that life is not fair. Life is not fair. On November the 12th, I saw Annie for the last time. Had no idea I'd never get to say goodbye to her. Had no idea this would maybe be it. It's interesting, just the day before that, I saw this on the internet. You know what it is? It's a GPS tracking tag that you put on the dog. So the dog goes up in the woods and you don't know where it is. You get your little iPhone out and you punch in the app and it tells you where the dog's at. You follow to the signal. You can find your dog this way. It's lost. That's no problem. I saw it. I thought, you know, maybe I should get one of those for Annie. She had it. She actually had a microchip with her identification, phone numbers, medical records and things embedded in her collar area up here. No, that's not the mark of the beast either, by the way. But she had this microchip, you know, all this identification embedded in her. If someone found her, they could take her to any kind of veterinarian, they have a thing to read the chip. She'd be easily identified. But here I could have found her if I just had had something like that, but I didn't. I had no chance to say goodbye. Today I have no knowledge of where she's at. I have no closure. That's not fair. I don't like that idea. But friends, we are all today. We are all today partakers of the effects of Adam's sin. Now, not his guilt, but of his sin. We all have diseased bodies, and we live in a fallen world with fallen natures. And we may say that's not fair. We weren't in the Garden of Eden. But I want to tell you, friends, that sin and Satan are not fair. And he is the prince of this world, the prince of the power of the air. And he's not fair. And don't expect everything on this life and in this world to be jolly and fun and great and good, because it's not. God, though, is not the bad guy. I'm going to tell you, and I'd be honest with you, and don't think I've ever shook my fist at God and said, I hate you, but I've been tempted. I've been sorely tempted by Satan to be mad at God, to blow up at him, to shake my fist at him and say, why? Why did you do this? Why are you responsible? Why aren't you being good to me? Why aren't you being fair to me? Here, I give all my life and I put all my effort, every sweat, drop of sweat I have, my blood into your work. And why did you let this happen? I tell you, I've been tempted to do that, but I've had to fight that temptation. I've said, no, that's not right. Because, friends, here's the situation. It is Satan who is the murderer. It is Satan who is the destroyer. And he wants me to think that God's the bad guy. Isn't that ironic? The bad guy tries to twist and spin everything to make us think that God, who is the good guy, is really the bad guy. But in John chapter 8 and verse 44, Jesus said it exactly as it really is. Jesus said, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He, that is the devil, was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Satan is the bad guy, friends. He is the one who's bringing destruction. He's the reason we have death in this world today. He's the reason that we have these kind of things today. We just cannot, friends, go by our feelings.
Amen.
The Bible says that we walk by what?
Faith
and not by sight.
Sight.
2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, isn't it? We walk by faith, not by sight. But faith is based on the Word of God. Faith is not based on something mystical. Romans 10, 17 says, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing what? The Word of God. So we walk by our knowledge of the Word of God, and the Word of God says that God is a life giver, the Word of God says life is good, and that God is good, and that Satan is a murderer. And that we have this problem, not because of God. Friends, we don't sometimes understand the mysterious, infinite ways and working of God. We don't always understand what's going on behind the scenes at times, but that is the way it is. Something I've learned very acutely is that love is pained by separation. This is not simply a matter of the amount of time at first, because I had been away from Annie on trips. I was on a trip to Europe this last year doing, you know, speaking and visiting. I was away on that trip longer than it's been since I've missed Annie now. So it's not simply just the time of being away. That's a factor. But it's when that separation is going to be permanent. And you know that separation is probably permanent. That brings an exceedingly painful situation. And the Bible teaches us that sin brings separation. Isaiah chapter 59, verse 2. Iniquity and sin is what separates us from God and causes this great chasm and gulf between us. And yet God is trying to buy us back. He's trying to redeem us. He's trying to get our attention. And I want to tell you something. I know something about the hurt of God now. When my son died 5 years ago, what, how long has it been? 5 years ago. I was pained and still in pain over that. Terribly pained over that. But I know that when the trumpet sounds, I'll see that son again. You know. But the thought that I'll never see a loved one again. In Jeremiah 31, verse 3, the Lord says, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. He may wipe away our tears. He may wipe away somehow our hurt, friends, but there's a hurt in the heart of God that never will be healed. Life is worthwhile. Life is worthwhile. This last week, I got a phone call. And he said, are you the guy that's missing a little white dog? And I said, yes. He said, well, you're going to get another phone call from someone in just a minute. And he hung up. And I'm not sure I understood the story about it, but in just a few minutes, someone called and they said, you missing the little white dog from Turkey Wallow Branch? I said, yes. Well, we're over here in Briarcreek, which is really just like one down and over from us, not that technically far away. By the crow flies, 8 or 9 miles to get there. I'm sorry, as the road goes, 8 or 9 miles to get there, but as the crow flies, very close. He says, well, I'm pretty sure we have your dog over here. He says, I can't get close to her. She won't let me get close to her, but I think it's her. I said, I will be there as soon as possible. Dropped everything. I was printing at the time, and I usually don't drop things when I'm printing very quickly. Went out the door, got on Indian Creek Road, and got behind the slowest truck you could imagine. Turned on the Briar Creek just after the school bus went by. And I'm thinking, the dog will be gone when I get there. She'll be gone. I said, oh, Lord, please, please, please don't. So I get there, and the guy's out waiting on me. These people were dog lovers, really sweet people, animal lovers. And they had seen up one of the posters that we put up at the post office near them over on Fan Rock. And the guy said, she's just around the corner of the road. She just went around the corner. And so I start taking off that way, calling Annie, because I know she'll come to me. And she's not there. So I go a little further, and there's another curve, and I go around that curve, and she's not there. I go a little further, and she's not there. I'm looking over the hill, down in the field, up on the bank, and I'm calling, and she's not there. And so I go back, and the guy says, she might have went up to the neighbor's house. He says, I'll drive up with you. So we went a little further up, and we were coming around a curve, and I could see the house, but I couldn't see much else. And the guy said, there she is. She's on the porch. And I'm just thinking, is it possible? And I look, and here's a little white Pomeranian dog. It's not a terrier. Well, she was, I don't know what happened to this poor little dog. She'd been set out or lost or something. She'd been injured a little bit. Hungry, obviously in need. We were able to coax her with some of the pepperoni and she was eating out of my hand, and she wouldn't let me catch her, but he said, that's okay. He said, just let me come back a little bit later. He says, I've got actually a capture cage, and I can get her, and we'll nurse her to health and help take care of her. I said, okay. But you know, I thought about that sweet and bitter experience, because as I left to go out there, I'll be honest with you, I was just crying and bawling, thinking about the possibility that I was going to get to, that maybe she really would be there. And then she wasn't there. I just felt, I can't say it's what our Adventist pioneers felt in 1844 on October 23, but maybe it was a little bit like it. It was a bittersweet experience. But one thing that I've learned from Annie too, and I just have a few more things. I know we're running a little long here today, but bear with me. Is that today is the day of salvation, and today is the day to do something if you're going to do it. If it's important, let's do it today. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, it says, today is the day of salvation, and I believe that. We need to live and pray like it is our last day on earth, because, friends, it just might be. It just might be. When Annie was injured and hurting, was in the hospital and having surgeries, so many people prayed for her when she was injured, and I appreciated that. But did I pray for her that morning that she left? Did I pray for her welfare? I fear probably not. Would have it made a difference in the plan of God? I don't know. It might have. But sometimes things happen in the providence and the plan of God that we don't understand, that we can't relate to, because we don't see behind the scenes. I think about Job. If we turn to the book of Job. Job had such a traumatic experience, far more than I think most of us, including me, of course, will ever have to go through. Job chapter 1 in verse 5. We know about Job. He was this perfect and upright man, but he had sons and daughters, and they would get together and feast. And verse 5 says, and it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job said, it may be that my sons have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. Thus did Job continually. I tell you, here's a man not only praying for his children, he's offering sacrifices for his children continually. Verse 18. As bad news was coming to Job, while one of these messengers was speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men, and they are dead, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Wow, that must have been very hard for Job. We don't always understand the ways of God and the providence of what He allows, but we need to live like this is the last day, because it may be, friends. We need to speak good words and show love to others today, because tomorrow may not give us that opportunity. We need to treat each person and each day like it might be the last, for you don't know, it could be. I remember very well the last time I ever spoke to my dad. It was a Wednesday evening. I'd been canvassing in the area. Brother Ron Trent was with me. And we stopped at the house to see Dad and Mom for a few minutes and had a real nice cordial visit for maybe 20, 30 minutes and left. And the following Monday, he was dead. And I had not seen him since. In fact, I was going to visit him that day. I was on my way to see him when he died. Could have maybe been there. Maybe could have saved him. I don't know. But today is the day I have to tell others that God is good. And I want to do that. There's an interesting story told in during the Cuban Missile Crisis. Just when everything was at its climax of intensity, President Kennedy had sent his brother Robert Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy was the Attorney General, to the Soviet Embassy to make one last appeal to the Soviet ambassador. And he basically sent him a message that the missiles are coming out or we're going to war. It's that simple. We're going to war and there's going to be nuclear war, because that's the only kind of war you run at that time. And that was tense. And so Bobby comes back and he's talking to the president, and the president has another aide with him. They just had actually taken a swim and they'd gotten out of the pool and they were going to have some refreshment, something to eat. And the president didn't seem to be too interested in eating. His assistant was just eating away. And Bobby's telling Jack about this meeting and how it didn't look good. There wasn't a lot of hope and promise out of that meeting. And Bobby looked at this assistant who was just eating away, and he says, "Man, what's wrong with you? You're eating like it's the last meal in the world you're ever going to have." And he says, "Well, from the way you guys are talking, it just might be." You know? And I tell you, it was close to the last meal millions of people had. It was just that close. But we don't know what tomorrow holds. And so if we have something we can do good for somebody, let's do it today. In Matthew chapter 26, there's a beautiful story. This is one of those few stories that's told in all the different gospel accounts. Matthew chapter 26, and verse 6. "Now when Jesus was in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, there came unto him a woman having an alabaster box of very precious ointment, and poured it on his head as he sat at meat. But when his disciples saw it, they had indignation, saying, 'To what purpose is this waste? For this ointment might have been sold for much and given to the poor.'" How pious it sounds. "When Jesus understood it, he said unto them, 'Why trouble ye the woman? For she hath wrought a good work upon me. For ye have the poor always with you, but me ye have not always. For in that she hath poured this ointment on my body, she did it for my burial.'" Somehow Jesus understood that this ointment had not been purchased for this particular moment. Mary was one of the few disciples who had the faith and the insight to understand the teachings of Jesus, and she knew that he was going to be crucified, and she knew he was going to die, and that he was going to be buried, and she had bought this for his burial. That's right. But she just couldn't. She couldn't wait. She just could not see how she could use this on his dead body when it could be given to him while he was alive to bring some kind of pleasure, blessing, and hope and joy to his heart. So she had that day, friends. She had that day, and she did something with it. And this account is given in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Jesus says anywhere this gospel story is told, this story will be told as a memorial for her. The last thing that I learned from Annie that I'm going to tell you about today, because a lot of things I learned that I don't have time to tell you about today, but this is the last thing I learned, is that God can use anyone for his service. God can use anyone for his service. In Romans chapter 6, and verse 13, Paul says, "Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but instead do this," he says, "but yield yourselves unto God, as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God." Now, it doesn't matter what kind of trade or profession you have. Most people have tools in what they do. A doctor might have a stethoscope, a scalpel, and band-aids. A carpenter has a hammer, a saw. You know, the electrician has his meter, his cutters, and knife and things. But friends, God has tools too, and he wants us to be those tools. We're the main tools that God has. And if we will surrender ourselves and submit ourselves to his workmanship, you know, I can take a hammer. We had a hammer in the youth Sabbath school class today, and I'm not sure who used the hammer the best, but it was the same hammer. Whether we missed the nail or hit the nail on the head, it was the same hammer, the same tool. The only difference between missing the nail and hitting the nail on the head is what? The person using it. It's the workman. And if God is the workman, friends, if we simply surrender ourselves to be used of him, he'll never use us in an imperfect or improper way. He'll only use us in the best and most perfect ways. And I don't care if we are young, if we are old. I don't care if we walk on two legs or we walk on four legs. God can still use us. He spoke through an ass to Balaam, didn't he? Mm-hmm. And I want to just say that Annie was a great instrument that taught me much. It's true she was not as obedient as she could have been, as I might like to have foreseen her. Sometimes I would be calling her, and she'd start to come to the house, and then she'd just start looking at me and then just sit. And I'm just sitting here, and if you want to come get me, that's fine. I'll let you pick me up and carry me and, you know, cuddle me to the house, but I'll just wait on you to come get me. And she would, and I'd go out and I'd get her, and I probably wasn't a very good trainer in that respect. But God was teaching me lessons of patience and service through Annie that I never realized. And the key is simply submitting to be the tool of God to do the work that he determines is the best work for you. And Annie was one of God's little creatures. And I think Many times he just whispered in her ear. And she did what he told her to do. This is really a simple story about a special dog who shared almost a year of life with me. And though she bore a very ordinary name, Annie, she was in fact a most extraordinary dog. Only such a dog would ever receive an invitation inside of Granny Ann's house.
That's right.
My memories of her companionship, loyalty, and love will linger with me as long as I have memory, and they will linger as colorful reflections. And so she did teach me many things, some of which are the value of life. She taught me that love is not always logical. It doesn't plan, budget, calculate. It does sometimes what seems to be the most unruly thing. Love accepts the unlovely, and it sees the potential below the skin or even fur. I learned that obedience keeps us safe from danger. I learned that life is not always fair, but God is there for us, friends, in our deepest trials. I learned that love is pained and sometimes terribly pained by separation. I've learned that today is the day of salvation. Today is the day to do something good, to say something nice, to be generous to someone else. And I've learned that God can use anyone who is willing. I got a picture of Annie when she was asleep one day. She sort of looks peaceful and resting there, doesn't she? Well, you know what? I still pray for Annie, because I don't know. I don't know if she found a home someplace else, or she's still just looking around, wondering with some other dogs, seeing the sights of the country. But, you know, hope is a very important thing, and it keeps us going sometimes when other things fail. I think that one of the greatest human stories of ingenuity and of rescue, maybe, is the story of Shackleton. When Ernest Shackleton, on his failed transantarctic expedition, they were taking the shipload of men, they were going to try to be the first people who ever crossed Antarctica. The year was 1914. World War I was just breaking out. In fact, war was declared the very day they left. And they were missing for a long time, and people just thought they were not going to return. And if they had known what had happened, they would be for sure that they could never return. The ship had been crushed by ice. I mean, this was the equivalent of being stranded on the moon without a rocket, almost. Just seemingly no possible way to return. And somehow, Shackleton and every single person in the expedition that he was leading on the ship Endurance lived and returned back home. Somehow, he got those people back home. They hoped against hope, I think, as Maxwell called it in his stories. So hope is important. But God has also used my love for Annie to help me to understand that it is often in our darkest hour that the Master is closest to us. He cares, and he cares profoundly. It is his presence which gives us peace. It is his nearness which gives us hope. It is his protection that gives us life. Amid this, he enjoys our company. He wants our company, just as we do our little friend's company. He loves to have us tag alongside. He too finds consolation in an eager, alert watchfulness that we show to him. In the midst of our trials or even danger, there can be delight. We need not be alarmed or anxious because he is there. And if he is there, friends, then all is well. And we should bless and praise his wonderful name. Even if we think the horses all got burned up at the barn, we're going to praise him anyhow. And so sometimes, friends, we weep with those who weep. That's right. The Bible tells us that. But God is still good. And friends, live today. Life is worth living. And it's wonderful if you have Jesus for you. And maybe. We also have a special friend that God uses to help you learn the precious lessons of life.